We are live here on the Frugal Crafter YouTube channel. I'm Lindsay here with Sarah.
Hello.
And we've got our tea ready and we've been gabbing like crazy already. So we're all warmed up and
we are
ready to paint and talk and answer your questions.
After missing last week.
Oh, I know.
And Happy New Year.
Yes. Happy New Year, everybody. I hope y'all had a safe ring into the new year. Oh, did you party? Did you do anything on New Year's Eve?
We went to a friend's house, John and I, and had a few drinks and played some Cards Against Humanity.
Oh, nice.
And, you know, nothing too crazy. I wasn't planning on getting too crazy. So, yeah, we had a great time, though.
Well, sounds great.
Had some food, had some drinks. Can't go wrong.
Wonderful. We are going to paint a vintage moth. I called it a butterfly in the title. Sorry, it's a moth. And it was from a vintage advertisement. And I have the photo on my website. Link is in the video description. I might have to scroll down a bit. I don't know if I put the link to the direct post. But if you go to thefrugalcrafter.wordpress.com, you will see the pattern you can print and trace onto your watercolor paper and the clip art that I used for this. It's an old eyeglasses ad, actually. And it's in the public domain, so it's totally fine for me to share it like that. We're going to be using Lucas paints, and I got these from our sponsor, jerrysartorama.com. They had a really good sale going, so I picked up this set. So if you are interested in any of the products I use, they're linked in the video description as well. And Jerry's has extended their year-end closeout sale. So if you've been looking to stock up on some paper or paint, go for it. Prices are amazing.
Close out.
I've hit the sale twice already. and I'm waiting for some supplies to come in so I can test them out because I might go back and order again. So, yeah. Yeah, it's
you have a problem.
It's not good. It's not. See, you know what? They might as well just like not pay me at Jerry's for doing their sponsorships because I just turn right around and spend all the money again.
Just have a running account for you.
Really, I know. I just need to have a tab. Oh,
wouldn't that be fabulous?
It would be. We're gonna be just using I haven't decided what colors I'm gonna use yet, but we're just you can use what you have.
What?
I know. I'm just in vacation mode, I guess, still after the holidays. I'm gonna wet the center portion of the body. And the reason I'm not doing the background first is that we have really smooth edges and solid edges on this butterfly, so I don't feel like I need to do that background. It's gonna be easy enough to put it in later if I decide I want to. I also have some stencils and stamps handy in case I decide I want to do some mixed media work on this. After. I'm going to grab some gold ochre, or like a yellow ochre-y color. Actually, this is yellow ochre. And I'm just going to add it in there and let it flow around. I'm using a paper that I haven't used much before on tutorials. This is the Strathmore Aquarius 2, and it's a mix of cotton and synthetic. So you've got the advantages of a cotton paper, but it's not going to wrinkle because of the synthetic particles in there. So if you think of like Yupo paper, if you've ever used that, it's kind of like a sheet of plastic and it lays completely flat, but your paint kind of goes crazy on it. It's tough to control. But this has the added benefit of kind of feeling like paper, even though it's got that synthetic mix in it. I'm going to grab some burnt umber here and add some of that along the edge. Oh, and if you have questions, just type them in the comments. Type the word question in all caps so Sarah can see it. I think I'm going to put together a frequently asked questions page on my blog because I get a lot of questions about what paints to recommend. And honestly, there's so many good ones. I think I just need to sit down with my thoughts and put all that down so people can kind of, you know, look at the list and see where they live and see what the deals are. So, you know, they're not buying one brand because I say it's good, but it costs 10 times more where they live. You know, they can kind of see what is best for them. I'm soaking up some of that water because this paper is it's not as absorbent, so I don't want to have quite as much water where I'm working. I'm also going to put a little genuine rose in here. That you can use permanent rose, you can use any of your PV19 pinks. And I'm going to use a little cobalt teal. I have a video that's going up this weekend reviewing this set of paints with a demonstration of pansy and butterfly. It's kind of a long video because of the demonstration. I probably should have broken it up into two, but you can watch it in bits or just watch the part you're interested in, I guess.
Spa Day Simmer. What is the best watercolor paper for a cheap price?
The Langton Prestige, I really like that. I just reviewed that recently and it was in the overstock sale at Jerry's, so I went back and ordered like a 10 sheet pack of it. But they have it in blocks or pads and I really like it. It's very similar to Arches. And I think it was $32 for 22 by 30 inch sheets. So those are those really big sheets that you could tear down to whatever size you want. I thought it was a great value. But also Strathmore 400, if you're looking for something that's not 100% cotton that performs pretty well, that works pretty well too.
Elizabeth Jensen, I just bought for the first time full-size watercolor sheets. The box said must open within 48 hours. Any idea why?
Yes, pretty much any. I notice whenever I order from art suppliers, they want you opening and checking your order right away. They don't want you to forget about it and then check on it in a month and realize you have a dented frame or you have a, you know, there's something wrong with it. They want to have that information right away so that if there is something wrong, you can rectify it. You can, you know, email them and they can make it right. That's the big reason.
Valerie Connell, can you ask Lindsay to mention the Legion paper she got for free?
Oh, yes. Val, I'm not sure if you can. You should be able to share a link, Val, because you are a moderator. Check the comments, guys, and hopefully, Val, if you remember, maybe you could pop this in the comments afterwards. Val shared a link with me to sign up for a free paper sample, and I think it was by the company that makes Stonehenge drawing paper and printmaking paper. They actually have a watercolor paper now, and they're giving out free samples, 8x10 samples, like I think 6 sheet packs. So Val hopefully can help us out with the link there in the video description.
She's probably already done it.
She probably already has.
Been posted to Facebook and YouTube and Instagram and wherever else, and has been linked to 1,000 things.
Yeah.
Valerie is...
She's on the ball.
Fast.
The nice thing is that you'll be able to try before you buy. So if you love it, then you can always order like a larger sheets of it or whatnot. I'm using Lucas Red, which is pigment 254, PR 254, if you're trying to match it with what you have. I think that's like a pyrrole red.
Rhonda Clark, what painting would you recommend for new watercolor painters of yours, paintings of yours?
I have one called Birch Trees and Blue Skies. That is a great one to begin with.
Fables, how do you decide which type of watercolor paper to use for your project? Hot, cold press, rough?
I think of the texture of what I'm trying to paint and I try to emulate that. I'm actually going to go in on this side and just go in and paint it dry and just see how the paper responds to a dry brush. Oh, I guess I already did wet this side. Never mind. Well, on the next section, we'll do it, go right in dry. I feel like I'm getting a really nice uniform wash with these paints and this paper. So like with this butterfly, I knew there was going to be a lot of smooth areas of color. So I chose a smooth paper. If I was painting like a rocky coast seascape, I might want a rougher paper because I want to have a paper that's going to work with the type of texture I'm trying to achieve. If you're doing a portrait, you probably want a smoother paper because then you can get those smoother skin details. But not always. I mean, some artists always paint on rough or always paint on cold press. Cold press is probably your most versatile paper because it's not too rough, it's not too smooth, and it just responds really well to watercolor.
Oh.
You okay over there? How are you doing?
Oh, God, I'm all caught up. Oh, boy. Oh, God. I just need to check on what Chewie's doing. I can't get out. She's too quiet.
She's too quiet. Well, I don't think she can get into much out there.
Well, if there's something to get into, Chewie will find it.
I've got some permanent green light here. I'm going to go in and add this. I'm just going to be really jumping around on this painting because I've got a lot of little sections. You can see there how the wet paint kind of flooded into the wet area. I'm not that concerned with it, but that will happen if you have areas in your painting that are too close together.
I love bread. What are watercolor pens?
They are pens with a water-soluble ink in them. They might be watercolor paint, but they're generally a dye. The only pens I know that have a true watercolor in them would be the Winsor & Newton watercolor pens, and they are excellent. I didn't care for their pigment markers that well, but their pens are excellent. we hit 300,000 subscribers here on the YouTube channel last night.
John told me this morning. I was like, what? Because I'm not on Facebook, crazy. So I didn't get the...
Pretty crazy. I was like, holy cow. The kids actually, my kids told me before I realized.
Well, good thing they're paying attention.
Yeah. Yeah, they were sharing it on their Instagrams. Oh, my mom's a famous YouTuber.
My mom is taking over YouTube.
Yeah, I'll be the next PewDiePie. Just as soon as people start, all wanting to watch painting videos. That was pretty cool, though. I mean, I don't really focus on the numbers too much, but that was pretty cool.
That's a good feeling. That's no small accomplishment.
You might be wondering why I'm using a lot more colors than typical. I want this to have the look of that kind of that vintage design look, and you're going to achieve that kind of, is going to be less realistic, more kind of bright and vibrant. Just going in and not mixing as many colors.
Stephanie Grams, how do I preserve my paintings?
You can put them, you can mat them and frame them under glass. That's the best way. There are also products that you can use to protect them, such as Dorland's wax. You can keep them in a portfolio away from light until you're ready to frame them. Basically, just want to keep dirt and light away from your paintings. I'm using a number 12 round. I like that you can get a lot of variety of strokes with this one brush. I'm letting some of that paint bleed into the color surrounding it just so I get a little bit of a covering more of the paper there.
Rhonda Clark, what did you use to trace your outline onto the paper?
I just used a pencil.
ZZ Minky, I'm going to try a new watercolor brand, and I'm confused between Holbin and Magello. Which brand would you recommend?
I guess it would depend if you're going with individual tubes and building your own color set, or if you're buying a pre-made set. If you're buying a pre-made set, I would go with Magello Mission Gold. If you're going to buy individual tubes, I would go with Holbein. I bought the set of 18 of Holbein colors, and I did not like the colors they picked. There was a lot of mixes in there, and I was kind of bummed out. And I don't feel like they put their best foot forward on that set. I feel like they kind of cheaped out, because almost all the colors were mixes. It was very disappointing. So if I was doing that, I would definitely go in and buy individual colors. But the Mission Gold, the Magello Mission Gold, they have some affordable sets. The set, I would recommend the set of 24 15 milliliter tubes, the pure pigment. So they have one set that's all single pigment colors, and you can mix all the other colors that are in their line, I think, from those. It's like all their pure colors. So you get actually 26 colors, because you get 24 of the colors you want, plus they throw in a black and a white. That's an excellent set that I recommend. I heard some people say that they thought their Magellos didn't flow very well, but I didn't have any issue with my Magellos not flowing. And I also have the 24 Perfect Pan set that I like, but I think you get more for your money when you buy the tubes. So here, what I'm doing, I think on this paper, going right on the dry paper, because it's just not as absorbent. So everything's just kind of sitting on the top. So I'm having no trouble blending. So I'm starting in with that permanent green light color. And I'm going to start that. I feel like I'm going to put a little bit more on this one. My paper's drying pretty fast here under the lights.
It's very dry today, too.
It's going to be like 10 below tonight.
Don't tell me things like that. Oh, now I'm cold. It's fine.
Well, it's not 10 below yet.
No, I know. At least the sun's out and it's not snowing. Kim's Craft Table. How long does it take half pans of watercolor paint to dry when you refill them?
Oh gosh, it completely depends on the humidity where you live and the type of paint and the brand of paint. They could be dry overnight, and they could take weeks. M. Graham takes quite a while because of all the honey in it. Holbein takes a long time to dry. I found my Daniel Smith to take quite a while to dry too. So it just depends, and there's no one answer for that, unfortunately. I just try to, what I don't do is cover them up completely. I'll just put them in their palette and I'll just lay a piece of paper over it or put the lid to the palette kind of kitty corner so air can get in there, because you don't want to seal it right up or it'll take a real long time. And I guess, I mean, if there was any bacteria in there, you could get mold. It shouldn't happen in new paints, but you know, if like you've been painting and your paint falls, your palette falls in the water out of your kayak and you, you know, seal it back up, you could get some mold issues. That's happened to me.
I was sensing that. Nicholas Sully, what is your opinion of Yarka St. Petersburg pan sets?
It's favorable. I think that they do a great job providing a good quality paint at a low price.
Kim Clifford, I use a watercolor journal. How can I get the pages to lay flat?
One thing you could do is spritz the back of the page and then weight them. You probably would want to interleave some wax paper in between your sheets so that you don't damage or have any pages stick together. You can also iron them if you can, like, find an area where you can get an iron. You can iron the back page or, like, put iron the back side of the page or put, like, a piece of typing paper down so that you don't scorch your paper.
Older and dirt, not quite this topic, but Sarah, have you changed your craft room since your video? I watched it again recently. I've changed it a little bit, but it's essentially the same layout. I've kind of rearranged a few things. I've actually gotten rid of stuff and donated them.
Oh, you have?
I have.
Good for you.
I know, right? But essentially it's still the same. Yeah, so I haven't changed it a whole lot, but a few things here and there. If anyone that had seen the video came into my craft room, they could probably find pretty much anything they were looking for.
Oh, so you pretty much kept it the same then, other than just a little purging.
A little purging. I rearranged how the paper and stuff was stacked and where they were, and kind of rearranged how I did some of my, like, everyday, like, stuff I use all the time, how it's on the table and where it is in relation to the table. But overall, the actual layout's pretty much the same.
Is there anything you would have changed that you did?
The only thing I would have changed is, and I'm going to eventually, is I would like to have a surface in between the tables that I could actually work on. Because right now, my big kick is on the floor. So I either have to drag it up to the table that I'm working on or use it on the floor or put it out in the dining room.
Right.
But I think eventually I will have like a work surface in between the tables, but I'm going to wait until we're going to rip the carpeting out, because I'm going to have to clean everything out anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And then I can just have John build me one.
Now, didn't you have a paper cart that was kind of wide that had room
for
your...
I still have that, but...
Your die cutter wouldn't fit on that? Or it's not sturdy enough?
There's no flat surface.
Oh, I thought that had like a board across it or something.
No. We talked about it, but I haven't done it.
Because
I have my jewelry tools that I store on one of the edges, like upright.
Mm-hmm.
So I have to take all those off. Gotcha. And plus I keep a lot of the stuff I use regularly handy on the top basket. So that would kind of interfere. So essentially, eventually, when the carpeting gets ripped out, I'm going to have to take everything out anyway. So then I will get my custom built shelf thing, work surface, because John can build that for me.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
It doesn't need to be fancy. You just need some shelves and a nice flat surface.
Yeah, it's really nice if you can leave your die cutter out, because you'll use it so much more.
And I leave it out, it's just on the floor.
Yeah, but having it someplace where you can just pop over, cut your die.
Exactly.
You know, it'll keep you using it instead of just, you know, if it's a hassle to get it out, you're less likely to use it, I think.
Jen K, has Lindsay ever tried Old Holland watercolors?
I haven't. I've heard good things about them, but I have never been in a store that sold them, and I guess I've never really noticed them online. I've heard good things about them from Handprint. There's a lot of good brands out there. Someone else was asking me about Blox watercolors earlier, and I've never used those either. Mixing some of the phthalo blue that I used in there. I used phthalo blue, then I went with the cobalt teal. I did the, that was cadmium yellow, light, cobalt teal, and now I'm going in with a mix of the permanent green and the phthalo blue. And I'm not pre-wetting my paper, because I've noticed that this is, it's really unnecessary with the Aquarius watercolor paper. And it's not terribly expensive. So if you're someone who, you know, doesn't mind a thinner paper and you hate to stretch paper, this will stay pretty flat for you. So like, I'm not having any buckling issues.
Mar Magoo, please discuss the differences, pros and cons between white gouache, white gesso, and white acrylic, especially opacity.
White gesso, a good quality white gesso will probably be a little more opaque than a white gouache or just regular white acrylic. Some white acrylic is pretty opaque though, but those are not reworkable. So if you decide to go over your painting and add little highlights with acrylic, if you decide you want to scrub that out or you want to blend it in with a wet brush, once it dries, it goes through a chemical change and you can't lift it back out. So that's something to be considerate of if you're doing watercolors. But chances are, if you are doing little white highlights at the end, you're not going to be going back in and reworking those areas. So it's completely up to you. Just keeping in mind that it becomes a mixed media painting at that point, and it's not a traditional watercolor anymore. If that's something that is important to you, if you're going to, you know, submit it for a contest or something that is a traditional watercolor, you're going to be kind of out of the running of some of those. But gesso is super matte acrylic paint, essentially. And it's very rough and toothy so that you can put other things on top. Watercolor doesn't stick to gesso reliably. If you want something that's like a primer that is an acrylic base that watercolors will stick to, you'll want a watercolor ground. And white gouache is just an opaque watercolor, an opaque white watercolor. It tends to be a little bit more opaque than a white watercolor, even though that's kind of opaque. The white gouache will be a little bit more opaque. I'm finding with these blends here, I kind of paint them twice. I go in first with my color, and then I go back in again to smooth things out. This paper is very easy to work with because it gives you that ability, I think, because it keeps all the paint on top. You're not like scrubbing. You don't have to scrub to lift or move your stuff around.
Nicholas Sully, do you like Fabriano Studio paper? I believe that's the student line.
For an inexpensive paper, I do. It's not going to take a ton of scrubbing. But yeah, I think it's a great value. The 140 pound is pretty good too. I use the 90 pound for stamping a lot. Anytime I'm doing like a rubber stamped card, I'll get the 90 pound hot press, and it's very affordable and it works great. You know, if you're not going to keep going into an area and adding tons of water, you don't need 100% cotton paper. So just match the needs of your project to the supplies that you're using. I feel like I could use a way less thirsty brush on this. I could use like a regular synthetic, and it would be just fine.
Kim Clifford, are there any student grade paints that have a good light, fast, and bright colors?
Oh, sure. Van Gogh, that's made by the Talens company, the same company that makes Rembrandt. Sennelier, Le Petit Aquarelle line. Cotman by Winsor & Newton. Grumbacher Academy, those all have really good light fast ratings. Lucas Studio as well.
Bev Roberts, will Lindsay add the names of the colors she used to her other info provided in the description?
I will do that. If you don't see it up, like probably an hour after the show or so, just give me a gentle reminder, but I can do that. I won't clean my palette so I can, so I can remember.
So you know which ones you used.
Yeah.
Rhonda McGee, why do they call certain colors permanent?
Because a lot of times you're giving the distinction between a older color that has known to be fugitive, like permanent alizarin crimson is not traditional alizarin crimson. It's made with a more modern pigment that is going to resist fading a lot more. So that's usually what they mean. It doesn't mean that it's not going to lift back up your paper. It just means that it's made to be more light fast than its historical counterpart.
Bev Roberts, have you ever used Nujabi watercolor paper? And if so, do you like it?
Yes, I do like it. It's whatever the grade is that you're buying is going to be rougher than what you're used to. So if you're buying rough, I mean, it's like super hills and valleys. It's a gorgeous paper, but it's super, super rough. The cold press is like what you'd be used to as a traditional rough paper. So just keep that in mind. But I really like it. I think that it's a wonderful paper. There's I wish I had a picture on my blog, but I looked and I didn't. In my Graphico shop, I have a PDF painting tutorial called Winter Chickadee, and I painted that on Nujabi. And I'm not sure. I think I used a cold press or soft press. I'm not sure. But it was it just has a beautiful edge to it. Like, if you like to frame your work so that you see the deckle edge, the edges are so pretty because it's a handmade paper and it's made in a deckle, and you get those beautiful deckle edges from the mold that it's made in. It's a really exquisite paper. It's not going to be as forgiving if you want to scrub away mistakes, though, so keep that in mind. I'm going to switch to a synthetic brush. I think that those Mimic brushes are a little too juicy for this paper. All right. I'm going to go in with the Rose Genuine and paint the bottom of these little semicircles here. I'm used to using quite a bit of water, so that it's kind of interesting to get used to this paper. I must have bought a bunch on sale because I had a ton of it in my stash.
Danielle, Justiniano, what would you suggest the best way to get better practice watercolor painting would be?
I would say paint. If you can get outside and paint directly from nature, that's a wonderful way to increase your speed. And when you increase your speed, you can increase your accuracy too, because you're looking right at what you're painting. Paint things you love. Just paint. That's the best thing. You can try making some mixing colors, make up some mixing charts if you want to. But you're going to learn that color theory by painting. So don't feel like you have to make all those charts. If you're willing to just start painting, and I would follow along with some tutorials, take some classes. I mean, even if you don't live near any classes, there are classes online. I've got a class at Craftsy. There are other art watercolorists that have classes on Craftsy. You know, have a look around. There's always sales too, so you can wait for a sale and then stock up. Here's a good tip. Keep a folder, and anytime you see a picture in a magazine that you think would make a pretty painting, or you like a certain flower in a bouquet in a picture that you saw, or seed catalogs, save all of them in a big folder. And then when you're sitting down, you have like half an hour to paint or whatever, you won't be spending your time looking for reference photos. You can just look in your file, pick something, and just start sketching and painting it. And you're just doing that for personal use, so that's totally fine. You wouldn't want to go and sell something that you painted from somebody else's photograph, but just for the sake of learning, that is absolutely fine. And that is, I mean, that's what my art teacher did when I was little. She had folders and folders and folders of different reference material, and it was so fun to look through her pictures. I mean, that was way before the internet, so, but it's a great habit anyway.
Nishtha Sharma, have you ever reviewed Rembrandt watercolor? Thinking of buying them. I need bright paints.
I haven't, and I'm kicking myself because I saw a really good sale on it right before Christmas on online, and I waited, and it hasn't been back down to that price since. So I'm kind of bummed. I wish if I see it go down again, I'm going to buy some, but. No, I've never used it. Their student line is really good, though, so I would imagine their artist line would be good as well.
Robin Cooper, when a pigment says 15-3, what does that mean?
PB15-3, that's one of the phthalocyan pigments. There's like here, you've got PB15:6. You've got PB15:1. PB15:3. So these are all from that same pigment, but I think it might have something to do, and please correct me if I'm wrong, anybody watching, if Rich is in the audience, he could probably let you know.
I haven't seen him yet.
I think it has something to do with how the paint is processed, like, because it's a synthetic dye and or a synthetic pigment, and it has something to do with how it's processed. They're all kind of green-based blues, but depending on what they do to the pigment, it'll look different. If you hear any weird noises, I just saw the oil man out back.
I was wondering. So. I was like,
Chewy's gonna start barking.
Nope, she's not. She knows. Theoretically. Maybe she'll bark. Maybe not. Did you find a crumb on the floor, Chewy? Kim's Craft Table. Do you know of a website of a color mixing chart for watercolors? My memory is bad, and I can't remember what colors to mix to get another color.
Oh, gosh, I'm sure there is. I think what I would do is, though, make your own chart. Put all your colors down one side of your paper. Like, just make, like, a column of your colors on one side and make the column of your colors up there and then mix the two together as they meet on your chart. I think that, I think there are some charts that are sold, like posters and things like that, but I honestly think it'll stick with you and you'll learn better if you just make your own. It's okay to overlap your colors. It helps you get that kind of offset print look that older advertisements would have. Let me give another layer of that yellow up there. It's looking a little weak.
Blueberry patch. Do permanent colors behave differently than their original counterparts other than light fastness? I mean, with regards to granulation, flow, etc.
Well, they could, but generally companies are trying to replicate every aspect of a pigment. But, you know, like a cadmium hue, cadmium red hue is going to be more transparent than a cadmium red genuine, you know, just because of those heavy minerals make it more opaque. It's, they're going to be a little different, but I think they're fairly well represented.
Amy Livingston, do you do your own framing? How can you keep the cost down?
By doing my own framing, as much as I hate it. what I usually do, there is a frame. It's a gallery frame available at Jerry's that I use a lot, and they're really good with the customer service. If there's a frame comes, it arrives with a ding in it, they will send you a new one. No questions asked. At least that's always been the policy anytime I've ever had a problem with any of my frames, but they generally don't have a problem with them. By the way, I just did that phthalo blue and some red, some of the Lucas red, and a little bit of green for that black that I just, all right, is that what I did? I did burnt umber, phthalo blue, and a smidgen of Lucas red for that kind of blackish color that I was making there. And I like those frames because they're wood. They come in several different finishes, and they're a thick. The profile's narrow, but the depth from the wall is kind of thick, so I can use them for canvases or watercolor. But it's got that beautiful gallery look, and it's simple, and it goes with most people's decor, so I don't feel like somebody's going to buy it and then it's not going to go with their decor and they're going to have to scrap it. So, you know, that's a thing when you're framing and it's on spec and you don't know if your work's going to sell, you got to kind of make it as universally appealing as you can. And that gallery style works really well. And it's not very expensive and it's usually on sale. So that's the gallery frames. It might be called Ambiance. That might be the name of it. Something like that. I think I saw some in the Overstock sale too. So go have a look. The link to Jerry's is in the video description. Go see what. But you can all, I like that because they also have glazing, and that's where you get into a lot of the cost is adding glass or plexiglass to your frame. And when you're doing watercolors, you need either glass or plexiglass. So since that comes included, that's a huge money saver. If you get like the aluminum frames, which in my opinion, you know, they have gotten better and they do look all right, but in my opinion, metal frames always look a little cheaper. And then you have to go and buy the glass. You're paying more doing that than you would be if you just went ahead and got a wooden frame that either had glass or plexiglass in it.
Alexandra Manga, are you going to try the new Jane Davenport mixed media watercolor line from Michael's?
Oh yeah, I totally am. I'm not even gonna pretend that I'm gonna resist that one. I am so excited to try that, which is very foolish because I'm sure it's not going to be that much different or or better than anything I have, but the palette is gold. It's gold. There's a gold one and there's a pink one. The outsides, it's not black, it's gold. How can I resist? I think one might be even teal. There's three.
A one in each color, people. One in each color.
Because the paints are different colors on the inside. And even if the paints are awful, I can still reuse the palette with whatever.
That's why I just said you're going to get one in each color because...
I am so excited. I if we had a Michaels near us, I would already own it. I'd already have them in my hot little hands because I would have been waiting when the truck came in.
You would have been that lady waiting outside the doors for the door to open.
Yeah.
With your coupon fisted in your hand.
And my teacher's discount. Because Michaels is an awesome teacher's discount. So,
Aisha Salmon, do you have any tips on controlling the brush and watercolor?
Yeah, one of my favorite tips is when you're using a round brush and you're trying to get a fine line is to go straight up and down. Hold your brush at a 90 degree angle with your paper so you know, your brush is straight up and down. That will let you work right on the tippy top of the brush. Keeping your brushes in good order, that means keeping them clean, not using your watercolor brushes for any other medium. That will make them...
wood brushes, don't leave them in the water overnight.
Don't leave your wood brushes in the water overnight. but yeah, that will really help you with control and also learning how to vary the stroke on your brush. So you press down with more pressure, you're going to get a thicker line. You press with less pressure, you're going to get a thinner line. Just learning those tricks, and they come with practice. That's really going to help you improve your skill.
Mar Magoo, I've noticed most artist watercolors label with a series number. To what does that refer?
It refers to how expensive they are because of how rare the pigments they've used in them are. So like a series one color like would be like your yellow ochre and burnt sienna and your earthy pigments because they're not as expensive to produce. And then you get like series two might be like dioxazine violet, some of the more expensive synthetic and natural colors. And then you can get like up into series four and five where three might be cadmiums and cobalts. Generally, the higher the series, the more rare the pigments are. Sometimes it's the pigments are more costly because they have some sort of environmental regulations against them, like a cadmium or a lead or something like that. So I don't know if those are more rare, if they just you have to go through more taxes or something. Something's driving the price of those up. But that's generally it. It's just, and that's how they price it. Usually series one paints are, say series ones might be $5 a tube and series two or $7 a tube and series three or $10 a tube, you know, just to help differentiate them. But it's because the pigments cost more basically.
Haru Siva, would the ridges in the water buckets harm the watercolor brushes, the faux brushes? Does your bucket have those ridges?
Yeah, I don't know. They're gentle. It's not like you're, you know, you just wipe them across the ridge and it helps knock the paint out of them. If you want to be real careful, just go in one direction. Don't go back and forth and scrub them. But I haven't had any issues with that, with any of my brushes. This is kind of like a coloring book. It's very relaxing. All these little spaces to fill in.
Kim Clifford, how do you know what colors you can layer without lifting the original pigment put down?
Well, some colors, and if you have a certain brand of paint you use, if you could find the color chart from the manufacturer, a lot of times they'll be labeled as staining colors or non-staining colors. Your staining colors, you can glaze over very easily without fear of lifting any of them, where your non-staining colors are going to tend to lift more. And the non-staining colors that tend to lift more are, if you think of colors that tend to be a little more opaque, like your yellow ochre and burnt sienna, ultramarine, those are all very granular colors. The molecules of pigment are big and they're resting on top of the paper because they're not tiny enough to seep down and absorb in. So those are the colors that tend to... that tend to be easy to lift because they're just sitting there on the top of the paper. Your dye-based colors like your phthalocyans and your quinacridones, they have teeny tiny little particles and they will sink down and grab into the paper and make it difficult to scrub them away because they're down deeper than the surface of the paper sometimes.
Like a tattoo for the watercolor paper.
Exactly, yeah, good analogy, yeah.
Jack Griffiths, how do you make a skin tone with watercolor?
I start off with yellow ochre and burnt sienna and a little bit of alizarin crimson, but there's so many different skin tones and so many different lighting variables that you really have to look at what you have. But, you know, an ultramarine blue. And I find that when you alter those three or four colors, you can get pretty much any skin tone. So if you need a darker skin tone, you want more burnt sienna and more ultramarine blue. If you have a fairer skin tone, you're going to have more yellow ochre and more alizarin crimson. And there are other colors you can add in there too, but probably the most important color that you're using is the white of your paper and controlling how light and dark your washes are. But I would practice with those colors and see how far you get. You should be able to replicate what you need with them.
Hovawart 16, Lindsay, have you ever heard of a U.S. watercolor company called Greenleaf and Blueberry?
Yeah, I follow them on Instagram. They've got they're handmade watercolors. I've never used them though.
Alexandra Manga, are you going to make another Craftsy class?
I hope so. I can't really comment on that at this moment, but I'm hoping to.
Kinsey Ramden, I'm debating whether I should buy the Liquitex paints. Do you know whether they are good or not?
When I have to use acrylic paints, they're usually the ones I go for. I'm not a big acrylic fan, but I do use Liquitex. I think they're probably they're the ones that I'm the happiest with, the Liquitex heavy body when I'm using them. I also like the Turner Acryl Gouache quite a bit, but they're not your typical acrylics. They have an ultra matte finish. So if you're after a typical acrylic, I don't know if you'd be happy with that, but that's what I go for. They're not the cheapest out there, but they're not the most expensive. I think Golden are probably more, and I haven't used Golden much, but I like Liquitex. If I have to use acrylics, they were what I would pick.
Renee C, when doing a pen and ink drawing, is there a way to cover up a mistake made in ink before adding watercolor?
Yeah, you could use a product called Watercolor Ground. There's also a product called Aqua Cover. It's like a whiteout for your watercolor paper, and they make it for different papers. So if you use Arches Natural White, they have one for that. They've got one for Fabriano. They got one for all the major colors. But I think that like the Daniel Smith watercolor ground would also fit the bill for that. And it's basically like liquid watercolor paper. You just paint it in the area you need to cover up, and there you go.
Linda DB, do you consider the Prima watercolor paints to be artist quality?
You know, they say they're artist quality on the box. I wouldn't really call them artist quality. They're nice, and for the money, they are an exceptional value. But the term artist quality is not like, it's not like the term organic. There's nothing that they have, that a paint company has to do or has to, a standard they have to meet to throw that label on their paints. I think they're a wonderful paint for the price. I don't think you're going to have a hard time to find a better $25 palette of paint. And I reckon probably the Jane Davenport paint is probably very similar to that, but there's no pigment information on any of the pigments that are provided. And for me as an artist, that is not acceptable. I use those paints. I like them. I take them, you know, out when I'm painting on location. They're fun, but I don't trust that they're not going to fade. So if there's something I love that I painted, I probably would scan it. They do have light fast information, but without the pigments noted that they use, I think it's kind of worthless. But I think they're bright and they're fun, and you can definitely learn how to paint and mix colors with them without any issue. I personally like them. I just wouldn't consider them artist quality for the sheer fact that there's no information. I feel like I disclaim everything I say. I feel like, don't take this the wrong way, but
that's because you like to not upset people. Unlike me, when I open my big mouth on a regular basis and upset people. Debbie Kalu, if you had to choose one watercolor palette and one paper type, what would you choose?
Oh boy. Probably M. Graham watercolors and either Arches or the new Langton that I just discovered. But I guess if I had to play it safe, I would go with Arches and M. Graham. But luckily, we don't have to make those choices. We can get a tube of this and a tube of that and come up with exactly, you know, the perfect thing for our art. We can mix and match. And I'm just layering these colors as I see them.
Pelure. Is there a good water board you can buy to do watercolors?
I usually just use a piece of foam core or a piece of masonite and tape my paper to that board. You can, there's Gator board. There are like boards that are meant to stretch your watercolor paper. I haven't used any of them, but yeah, there's lots of things available to buy. I feel like I want this darker. You can see how much it got lighter because of all the water that I put on there. It shifted quite a bit lighter. So I'm going to go ahead and repaint that right on the dry paper. I'm going to show you what I was talking about, the brush control there. So I'm on the tip of my brush here at the end, and now I'm pressing to get that thicker line. I'm going to come back up on the tip as I get to the edge there. I'm going to reload. And I'm always pulling the brush in a manner that's comfortable for me. So I'm not pushing the brush. I'm pulling it towards myself. If I feel like I'm really in an awkward situation when I'm painting, I will simply turn my board around. That's a benefit of taping it to a board versus your table, because then you can lift it up and move it if you need to. So up on the tip, and then I'm pressing as I want a thicker line. And you can just practice lines like that on some scrap paper, even just typing paper, and get the hang of it, so you're not like wasting your watercolor paper, but you're getting that practice in. Do the same thing over here, up on the tip of the brush, push, bring it around and down to that tip and lift up. Reload. Any more questions out there? Or are they quiet down?
There was, but the good old moderators are catching them for me.
And so I want to pull towards myself, so I'm going to start back up here and bring it around towards myself.
Mar Magoo, for a decent practice paper, would you choose Fabriano or Strathmore 400?
I think the Strathmore 400 is a better quality than the Fabriano Studio. If you're talking about the Fabriano Artistico, the Artistico is an artist grade paper. I probably wouldn't use that for practicing. But the Fabriano Studio is a little bit less quality than, although it does have cotton in it. I don't think that the Strathmore 400 has quality, has cotton in it. I feel like the Fabriano Studio is not as heavily sized or something. It doesn't seem to be as resilient as a Strathmore 400. So if you're just putting those two next to each other, the Studio versus the 400, I would go with the 400. All right, I want to fill in this area here. I'm going to use two colors. I'm going to use my Lucas Red, and then I'm going to fade it into my Rose Genuine, and I'm going to start the Lucas Red over near the body of the moth. I love these psychedelic colors.
I think you should put some googly eyes on this.
Oh, moth. That would be so funny. Well, I brought some stamps and stencils down because I was thinking I would want to mix media it. That would be kind of cool.
Leah Gaffar, what do you think of the Canson Montville paper?
I like it. It's quite heavily sized, though, so it might feel very slippery. If you're not used to that that much sizing, it's also smoother than you'd expect. It's smoother than typical cold press, and their rough is more like a traditional cold press. And I'm going to rinse my brush and grab the rose. And just blend them where they meet.
On my screen, that looks orange.
Oh, does it? Huh. Yeah. Oh, yeah, it does look more orange. Yeah,
but it's definitely sitting here, a foot, 6 inches from you. It's definitely red.
Hmm. Hey, but that Lucas Red does have like a kind of orangey red undertone.
Mm. Azalea P, do you often outline your painting with black pen?
Sometimes. I usually don't outline it. I would draw it in first if I was going to do black pen, unless I don't have the contrast that I need and I just I don't feel like the painting is working because it doesn't have enough definition, then I would go in with a pen. But generally, if it's pen and ink, I've done the pen first. The neat thing about the synthetic paper is that I can go back in and I can blend my colors together quite a bit. I wonder how this would be with like a watercolor marker, like Tombow markers and stuff.
Oh, yeah. That would
definitely... I bet that would work really well. I think I might have to cut some of that down small. You should take some home with you so you can use it with your stamping.
Sure. Sure. Nicole Faulkner, what setting do you use on the iron when you iron your paper flat?
Oh, boy. I think I use dry and as hot as it goes. But that's also how I cook, so I don't know if that's a good piece of advice or not. Cook it faster, right?
Yeah, yeah, that's true. The hotter it is, the faster it'll cook.
Yep.
Jack Griffiths, have you ever mixed cross-hatching with watercolor or using the ink to darken? I'm assuming for shading, but that would technically not be a watercolor. It would be mixed media, right?
Or pen and ink and wash.
Yeah.
I have done cross-hatching and watercolored over it, like done the cross-hatching in pen. I have done some, like on my Blue Jay Feather tutorial that's on my YouTube channel, I did do some hatching, but it was just only a subtle cross. It was to get the flags and the feather, to get those little... that texture of the little feathery bar. I don't know what they're called, the fletchings maybe. So that was a hatching technique with a tiny brush. You might want to check that out. I think that might be what you're talking about. But yeah, you could do pen and ink. You could do watercolor over any pen and ink technique.
Alexandria Curry. How do you feel about Bristol paper? Also, Caran d'Ache Neo Color 2.
Oh, fan of both. I really love the Neo Color 2 crayons because they're opaque and they will show up on matte board. So I like to use those most on matte board or a heavy colored cardstock because it takes a lot of the work out of a painting because you have the background all done. They're also really great to go over a watercolor with because you can they're opaque. You can put them on top of anything. And you can even stuff out, especially on like portraits, anything like that. They're a wonderful product. I can't recommend them high enough. They're kind of pricey, but they're great. And Bristol, the different companies make it to different qualities. I think I've only used Strathmore and Canson, but in my limited knowledge of the product, I like it really well for stamping. And I've even used like alcohol markers on it, and I've used watercolor markers on it. Watercolor pencils on it. It's a very durable paper, especially if you're a crafter, like a rubber stamper. It's just like kind of like a super heavy, like cardstock.
Lily Mock, what is your favorite palette?
One watercolor palette. For a studio palette, I really like the Pike palette, P-I-K-E. The standard and extra large wells, depending on how big of pans you want, but I like those. I do like these tin palettes here. For travel, not this big for travel. I just like the smaller ones for travel, but those are all pretty much the same. I mean, from manufacturer to manufacturer, there's not a lot of difference. But as far as a big plastic studio palette, I like the Pike.
Ooh, right. Azalea P, does it make a painting look less realistic if I outline the painting with black pen?
It's going to give it a little bit more of a cartoon look. So it will look like a drawing, but I mean, there are paintings that were done just in paint that may not be realistic looking. So it's just a type of, it's just a look. It has a like kind of a doodled look to it. I don't think it's a bad look. I don't think it's a unartistic look. I think it just depends on what you want.
Little Joker Jr., I just got watercolor brushes from Royal and Langnickel. Do you know if they are good? It's my first set of brushes.
The Royal and Langnickel make a lot of really nice brushes. I don't know what brushes you have, though. They make a lot of brushes. I like their Majestic and Aqualon and Zen brushes for watercolor. If it's one of those, then yeah, you've got some good ones. I don't know every one of their brushes, but I find them to be pretty good quality.
Awesome, Joy. Is there any good varnish or gloss for watercolor painting?
I haven't used any.
I just like to ask you questions about stuff like that because you always cringe a little bit. Because Lindsay doesn't use varnishes or sprays on her paintings at all. So when someone asks about it, she cringes a little bit.
Yeah, I think matte and gloss is the best practice for watercolor. Although I did buy some Dorland's wax I haven't used yet. That's for like putting on top of your paintings so that you can varnish them or mount them on wood or whatever. Because I was kind of curious to try that technique, just thinking it might be a less expensive way to frame them. But I haven't used them, so I can't recommend them until I do. That wouldn't be very ethical to recommend something I haven't used yet.
Patricia Mexico, are Lyra Aqua crayons comparable to Neocolor 2?
Yes, very much so. They're probably not quite as opaque and creamy, but they're pretty darn close. They're probably the closest. And I use them. I use both of them together sometimes. The Lyras are less expensive. I don't think they come in as many colors either. But yeah, very comparable. I think that the differences are very minute.
Hannah Marie, any advice for proper lighting setup when doing a watercolor painting so there isn't a glare?
Not really. I don't really see too much glare when I'm painting. Sometimes when I'm filming, I get glare. It's the angle that you're looking, that your board is tipped at. If it's like facing a light source, you're going to get a little glare, but you can usually tip it a little bit to get over that. Here I've watered down some of the burnt umber, and I'm just going to flick in little light brush strokes for the fuzzy antennas.
Starshine Soldier, did the bottle cap watercolor palette you made ever rust?
It didn't, but I gave it to the kids, so I don't know what happened to it. as long as I know, it hasn't. But
as long as you had ownership
as long as I'm aware of. I'm going to scribe in some little marks there, too, because I got a little too wet with the paint. Now I'm just going to add a little more paint so that it shows up more. Trying to keep my hand out of the camera away. Actually, I'm just going to paint that and then scrape my lines. Actually expecting a jury's order any day.
Oh boy. I've been very good and have not been online to order anything. Well, because I've been having a problem. I found this website called thriftbooks.com.
Wow.
Which is essentially a giant used bookstore online.
Oh man.
And if you order $10 or more, you get free shipping. And then when you hit $50 worth of orders, they give you $5 off your next order.
A slippery slope there, I can tell already.
Yeah. Oh, yes. I have so many books now on my bedside table. I've literally cut myself. I'm like, I can't go online. I can't order anything more.
Do you have the Jenga pile of books that if you don't put one back right, then they're all going to tumble to the ground?
No. I stack them a certain way. And I'm going to have to rearrange that when we get the new bedroom furniture tomorrow. Because I'm not sure how they're going to all fit in the new nightstand. But it's literally the nightstand I have now. They are literally stacked on the floor. And then I have all the library books. I'm like, Thrift Books is becoming my Jerry's.
I think you should have got a matching bookcase to go in your bedroom in your new bedroom set.
Well, I don't know that they made a bookcase, and we do have a bookcase in there now. So for now, I don't think I remember seeing a bookcase, like a matching bookcase. That's okay. But yeah, so that I have not been going online to avoid
temptation.
So I'm like, well, because then I have my Goodreads app, which lets me save a list of books that I want to read. Mm-hmm. So it's just a quick stroke of a few types. And it's all the options. And oh my, it's awful in a good way.
There's these little red marks here. I'm just putting them in. They're like little comma strokes, kind of little C strokes. I love these colors. They're so...
It's very vibrant. Right. With our flat landscape colors right now. I guess not flat, but white and blue.
White and gray and blue, gray, yeah.
Dirt, dirty snow. Azalea P., do you have any tips and tricks for painting landscape in real life? I find it really difficult to paint from real life.
I think you need to lower your expectations because you're not going to have all the tools that you do in your studio. You have to limit yourself or you're not going to get anything done. Bring a small set of colors, no more than 12, in a little palette, a water brush or a small like bucket of water. Underpack, if anything, underpack, because you're probably not going to need all the things you think you're going to need. And as soon as you get there, just start painting. I think that we kind of get this paralysis when we start to create, especially if we're nervous or we don't know where to start or we're afraid somebody's going to watch us and we're embarrassed. You just have to get there and start painting as quickly as you can so that you can kind of get over that and just start painting what you see. Plus, like, if you go anywhere with your children, you're going to learn how to paint quick because they're not going to be happy just hanging out someplace for a long time while you paint. So you gotta, it will help you with your speed. And I think it's a great thing to do.
Isis Osborne, is it okay to use a toothpick if you don't have a credit card?
Sure, use anything you want to scrape those lines.
Nicholas Sully, when I purchase from Jerry's, is there a way to support you like clicking through your link?
Well,
you drew from your link. I just told customer service you'd sent me.
That's fine. That's hey. I don't get a cut of your sales.
But
they sponsor these videos and that really helps out a lot. So if you let them know that I sent you, that's fantastic. Helping bring awareness to their products and their website. I love it because I don't think you can find the prices lower anywhere else. So they'll be sending you there anyway. So at least I get.
Yeah, really. But it's good for them to hear that people are coming to their website because of you and your recommendations.
Yeah. And it also helps all YouTubers, I think, because most YouTubers make their living from advertisements, either ones that run on their video beforehand or brand deals and sponsorships. And when companies see that, working with YouTubers is as good as working, you know, directly through like with Google or some other ad buying outfit, it gives more validity to all of us. So I think that what's good for one of us is good for all of us.
Rhonda McGee, what was your first YouTube? Hang on, sorry.
That's okay.
Your first YouTube was about, so I assume you mean your first YouTube video.
What was my first YouTube video about? It was a card making video. It was, I think it was like an Asian inspired card. I think it had like a little like a little kitty. One of those little lucky kitties, lucky waving cats. You know what I mean? I think that's what it was. I'm doing some line work. I'm using yellow ochre and cad yellow because those colors tend to be more opaque. So I think I can go right on top of these and add the veinings and the wings. I don't want them to be super strong anyway, so the fact that I'm doing this last with a lighter color, I think will keep it from being kind of gaudy and overdone.
Deborah Sullivan, I got a book for Christmas called Blue and Yellow Don't Make Green. The author claims that grade school formulas for mixing colors doesn't work. Wondering if Lindsay has heard of it.
I haven't heard of that. But as you're painting with artist paints, you get a little more sophisticated with your painting because, well, for one thing, there's a lot of different shades of red. There's a lot of different shades of blue. If you take ultramarine blue and mix it with cadmium yellow, you're going to get a very grayish muted green. It's not going to be that bright, vivid green you want. If you mix, cadmium red with phthalo blue, you're not going to get purple. You're going to get kind of a black. So yeah, I think that in some cases it is that's true. But you know, if you get the right blue and the right red, they're going to make the color. That's why I really believe in a split primary palette, which is a warm and cool version of each color of each of your primaries, because then you can mix everything you need. I'm turning this around because it's easier for me to work on this side of my paper, and I'm going to put the veins in on this side. And this brush I'm using is a liner. It's got a really long, thin bristles, so it holds a lot of paint, and it keeps a nice point. I don't have to reload it as often. And I'm just deciding, guys, let me know in the comments if you want me to do a background on this and if I should just paint a background or if I should do some stamping or...
I'm actually caught up in the chat.
Oh, okay.
I'm not sure how this happened, but it did.
Awesome. You can freehand in a few more veins if you want to. If you see that it's a little sparse, go ahead.
Background. We have a vote for background with multiple exclamation points.
Ooh, okay.
Funky background with splatters, Dominique Design says.
Oh, okay.
We have a vote for no background. Another background vote. 1, 2, 3 background votes and 1 stamping. Background, stamping.
Well, I would probably do stamping over the background.
Ooh, that, whoa. Now, I second the splatters. I would love to see an actual background painting. Background. So, yeah, I think people want to see something in the back.
Okay, cool. Whatever it may be. All right, I'm just going to put a few dark accents here. This is a mix of burnt umber and phthalo blue.
So you need to get some sequins or some jewels to put on there with the googly eye.
Oh, sequins.
See, now I'm getting that... my finger didn't show up. I was like, oh, God, my finger's probably in
here.
Nobody wants...
Well, you don't smear my paint. I don't care.
No, but I still have a little green paint on my hands.
You touch the oil painting over there?
No, from painting the bedroom the other night.
Oh, yeah.
I get paint all over me. Alan Smith, could Lindsay explain the difference between the cakes of paint she is using and the tubes of watercolor paint and why we should use one or the other?
There's really no difference. It's personal preference. When I buy a tube of watercolor, I let it dry in a palette, so I essentially make it into a pan. Some people prefer to use it fresh out of the tube, and that's fine. You can use it however you want. I feel like you waste a lot when you use it fresh out of the tube, so that's why I don't. And I feel like my colors are obviously just as bright using them from the pans. I mean, I don't know. Do you want it brighter than this? You'd burn your retinas out. I mean, I think this is bright enough.
Then it would be tacky. Lindsay, Gwyneth Simmons. Lindsay, have you tried the Jack Richardson Art Semi-Moist 24 Watercolor Set? I saw them on sale at Dick Blick for $5.64.
No, but
instead of 24.
Sharon Cullen on YouTube has a tutorial, has a review of them. If you want to go check hers out and see how they paint. I don't have them. Okay, background. All right. I don't know what colors I'm going to do for the background, but I'm going to start by wetting the background just because I think with a large area like this, I am going to want to wet it first. And I'm just using this 3/4 inch flat. It's part of the value set of the Mimic Squirrel Brushes at Jerry's Artorama. I'm not going to go right up to the butterfly, though, just in case any of that paint is still wet. I don't want to pull any of it into the background. I think my paper is going to stay wet enough that I don't have to worry so much about it drying on me. Actually, I kind of like this against the white. Usually by now I've messed something up in the background that I have to paint one in to cover up a fingerprint or something. And I accidentally used the wrong lotion today. I got this new lotion that I really like. I've been using it for a couple of weeks called Gloves in a Bottle. And it doesn't leave grease on my fingers. But today I accidentally grabbed the stuff I used to use, which is like basically feels like Crisco. And I didn't realize it until I was tracing my pattern.
The Body Works Antibacterial Moisturizing Hand Lotion.
No, it's a really thick, it's like a creamy petroleum jelly, like really, really thick lotion. And I'm hoping that I don't have any resistant spots here. Hopefully the paint sticks to everything. If not, that's going to be a great stamping opportunity.
Amy Price, have you ever tried the Studio 71 paints?
No, I haven't. Wait. Yes, Consumer Crafts. Yeah, I tried their acrylic paints. They're actually got them for one of my kids, and they're fine. The glowing endorsement. They're fine.
They're fine.
I've only used like one of the colors, so I can't really, I haven't used a ton, but I used one of their acrylics and it was just fine.
Watercolor Gypsy. Lindsay, how do you feel about having 300,000 subscribers?
Pretty good, actually. It's pretty awesome.
Yeah, it is. It's fantastic. I'm just riding your coattails to through the YouTube Hall of Fame here. Gripping on tight.
I'm using cobalt teal because I like the granulation effects that it gives. And I've already used it in the painting, so I know it's going to match. So basically, I'm just adding it really close to the butterfly and letting it wick out into the background. I really don't have a plan for my background. That's just that's the color I think that's going to make the butterfly stand out the most.
Brenda Collins Deeks, have you tried any of the Staedtler paint sets?
I haven't. I've used their watercolor crayons and their watercolor pencils, and those were nice. If you're working with a color that granulates and you want to encourage it to granulate more, work with a lot of water because it helps the pigment particles separate and settle out. So you'll have that pretty you'll have more of the granulation on your paper.
Bev Roberts, when you use something as a resist, do you scrape it away at the end of painting?
Usually not. It depends. Like if I'm using wax, I just leave it on. If I'm using embossing powder, I would just leave it. You can iron them off, probably not scrape them away because you could damage your paper, but you could lay a couple sheets of clean typing paper on top and then maybe some newsprint and use a hot iron to remove it. But I just leave it on. As long as it's not acidic and not going to hurt my paper, I'll leave whatever on. The only resist I remove is masking fluid, like removable masking fluid.
Annie Tanner, whatever happened to Ask the Crafter?
Well, it's just tough to get three people together all the time. Honestly, that's one of the biggest...
Kids in life.
Yeah, the biggest things. And to be honest, that program got the least amount of views and gave me the most headaches with people complaining about it. So,
People complained?
Yeah.
Get out of town.
Yeah. So when you just constantly get complaints, then... It just makes you not want to do it.
It just loses its fun.
Yeah. That's just because everybody wanted it their way. And nobody, you know, you just can't please everybody. And people were very vocal when they were not happy. And I'm just like, you know what? This is supposed to be fun. I'm not.
And it's a free video, too. That's the best part. It's free, people. Free. Laura R., how do you decide whether to add a background or not?
I just let you guys decide, basically. If I make a mistake and I drop some paint where I didn't intend to. Generally, I prefer a background. Would you pass me that painting back there that's got the...
This one? Or
yeah,
this one?
The one on the clipboard there.
Okay.
This one is one I'm going to be posting on my YouTube channel this weekend. I did not do a background. I planned on not doing a background, and I actually wished I had done a background, but at this point, getting around all of that, I didn't want to deal with it. So I usually do decide beforehand if I'm going to do a background or not, and then I put my background in first. But sometimes I might not intend to do one, and I make a mistake, and I get a smudge in the background area, and I decide to, or sometimes it's like today where I wasn't sure if I wanted a background or not. So I just, and I had pretty smooth edges and easy to get around. So I decided to wait and hold off. So those are the three main reasons where I might put on a background or just leave it and not do a background.
Paul Adams, have you ever tried pouring watercolors? I just discovered that's a thing people do and I'm intrigued.
I have, but I haven't in a long time. And I actually have some Dr. P.H. Martin's watercolors that are liquid that have, droppers, it would be ideal for that technique. Maybe I'll do a video on it. I haven't done it in a long time, though, because I don't work as... That's usually more for, like, larger-scale works, and I don't work as large as I used to. I think I'm going to go with a secondary color around the edges and... pull it in.
Yeah, that turquoise is quite lovely.
Thank you.
In the back there. Pops. It feels more centered, like it's not just floating.
Yeah.
Meadow Hill Farm CT, which I assume means Connecticut. I purchased the Phoenix tubes and tried to put them on a pallet to dry, but they end up cracking and falling out. Is this possible?
You can add some glycerin or honey to it. I have not used the Phoenix tubes. I got the Phoenix pans at Ocean State Job Lot, and they haven't cracked.
Yay, cat hair! Yeah. That could be chewy hair, I guess.
I think it's cat hair. I think Tally gets up here.
Oh, yes, you were saying she likes to mark. People are very excited about the pansy painting tutorial.
Oh, good, good. It's a long one. So, well, it's probably only about half an hour of tutorial, because there's a 12-minute review at the beginning of it. So if you do want to skip around, I don't blame you. That's I'm doing yellow ochre on the outside. I think just I think the cadmium yellow might be a little too much, too vivid to put in there.
Azalea P., do you have tips and tricks for food illustration using watercolor?
Yeah, I think that texture is the big thing when you're doing food, especially if you're doing like cakes and pastries and frosting. And to get, you want to get that, you really want to get that texture right. So I would say a variety of brushes, maybe even some sponges that you can dab texture, working in layers, taking your time, and make sure that you're working on something that you really enjoy, you know, a subject that you really like, so that you don't get bored before you're done in illustration, because to get it right, I think you will plan on spending a little bit more time.
Judith A. Rowland, have you tried Block X watercolor?
Blocks? No, I haven't. Somebody else had asked me that. No, I've never used that brand. I've heard it's reputable, but I've just never personally had a chance to use it. I think I want to add a little bit more of the teal in there just to kind of blend them together, because the paper was drying and giving, I think it was going to give me some hard edges if I didn't. You can see the paper with all this water in here is now starting to cockle a little bit, but it should dry completely flat. I'm not going to worry about that, but this is a lot of water. So what was your question?
Hovawart 16, I was thinking of using some liquid gum arabic to glue some chunks of watercolor that fell out of my palette back in. Any reason not to try this?
Nope, that's fine. All right, now I'm going to go through, and any big puddles, I am going to mop up with this big brush. So I'm just drying the brush off and lay it in the puddle, lift it off. And usually the paint will just kind of fill in that area that I've lifted, so we shouldn't have any like white spots remaining. And then I'm going to dry this, and we are going to use our watercolor paint as stamping ink, and we're going to do a little stamping on the background.
Whoa.
I know. Whoa. So I'm going to have the heat tool on for a minute. Go ahead and ask any questions as they occur to you. I'm drinking my tea.
Step 13, what type of brush is that huge one? Well, it's the one you use all the time.
Yeah, it's
one of your favorites.
Number 30 round mimic. It's a faux squirrel. Linked in the video description. It's part of the value set, which is, I think, $29, and it has a lot of brushes in it. So if you can swing it, I highly recommend that, because that's what I have, and I feel like I have every brush I need.
Brenda Collins Deeks, my Reeves paint set has a few near empty pans. Should I be looking for replacement pans for that set, or is that one we just refill from other tubes?
I think I would. I don't think they have replacement pans. I would go ahead and if you're using that much of that color, invest in an artist quality tube of paint, or maybe even a Winsor & Newton Cotman, which would be a step up from the Reeves.
And Brenda, you've been a frugal crafter for a while. You've been painting. It's time to
you could treat yourself.
Step up a little bit. Older and Dirt, how did you decide which background colors to use?
Well, the red in here, I think that kind of cool red, a nice opposite would be kind of like a bluish green. So that's why I went with that turquoise. makes the colors just kind of pop. And I didn't want just stark white out here, so I went with some yellow ochre just to kind of fill in so it wouldn't be too competitive with the other colors I'd used. Well, I must not have left any grease spots on my paper because I don't see any...
I don't see any resisted spots.
That's good. Okay, I think that feels pretty dry. And I have got a basket of stamps. I also got my watercolor crayons. Maybe I'll use the watercolor crayons,
Boy. I think you should. I vote yes.
You vote yes. Oh, I like this one right here. This nice corner. This is an old Tattered Angels stamp. I don't know if I can do this with my... I think I'll be able to do this with my hands. I'm going to do this with red. So why don't I... I'm just looking to see if my mega mount is up here. I guess I don't think it is. That's all right. You know what? I'll use my... I'll use the back of this packaging. Okay, so I think I will, first we'll do some stamping with a paint, then we'll do some stamping with watercolor crayons, and then I think we might even add a little stenciling. So that should give you some ideas. I'm going to switch over to a brush that is a little bit stiffer. This is a Princeton Real Value wash. I actually like this line of brushes. They're very affordable for a regular synthetic brush. They do not act like a natural brush at all, but if you're looking just for a good synthetic brush, it's a good buy. So you gotta get your paint to the right consistency, so that will take a little bit of trial and error. And I'm using the brush almost flat with the stamp. I'm just trying to get the edges. I don't really want to get my paint down in the gullies. And my stamp is on the clear backing, so I'm not like getting paint spilling onto my design. You kind of want the paint as dry as you can with it still being able to stick to the stamp. So you don't want it really watery, or it's just gonna slide down in between the design. But you don't want it too thick, or it's not gonna come off your brush. Okay, so after I've got this applied, and you're not going to get a perfect impression like you would with an ink pad, so keep that in mind as well. So I've got that inked up. I'm going to spritz this with water off camera so I don't hit my painting. And now I'm going to stamp it in the corner. Now with this piece of plastic packaging here, I can see where I'm making contact and not, so that's kind of nice. Oh, actually, that got a pretty good impression.
Ooh, that did come out.
I think
out
I'll
nice.
Do that.
Put some glitter on it. I'm just kidding.
I think I'll do that on both bottoms. I don't know if I have room to do them in the corner ones.
Brenda said that she actually splurged and bought a set of the White Knight 48 artist quality half pans.
Oh,
for
nice.
Christmas.
I didn't know they came in half pans. I thought they only came in whole pans.
She got them from Jerry's.
I bet she got the whole pans. That's awesome. That's a great paint. It's one of the more affordable ones. Like, it's like Lucas. It's a fairly affordable artist grade paint. You must have favorable trade with Germany and Russia for, you know, sir. Because it seems like Lucas brand stuff. And
for now.
Stock up, people. Stock up.
January 20th is right around the corner.
You know,
for those of us in America.
That has gone through my mind. That is like, because I was thinking, because I think that's probably what spurred last couple big orders that I put, because it's like, oh, am I going to be able to get this?
No, I think we'll be all right. He's hammering down on Obamacare first.
He's got bigger fish to fry
so
than
get
our
all your get all your doctor's appointments in now.
Oh, really? Seriously.
Tessa Reed, looking for a bigger set of watercolor pencils. I have Prisma and like the creamy feel. Can you recommend some high quality choices? Maybe Albrecht Dürer?
Yes, those are very good ones. The Albright Dürer from Faber-Castell. Also, anything Caran d'Ache makes is pretty darn good, but pricey. If you're looking for an affordable option, the Spectrum Noir Color Blend watercolor pencils. Are they Color Blend? Aqua Blend. I'm sorry, Aqua Blend. Are really nice. I like them much better than the regular color pencils. Their watercolor pencils are good, and they say they're light fast. I don't. It's hard to say with a color pencil or a watercolor pencil how light fast it is, but they claim that they're light fast. Okay, I want to do something up in the top corner. I think I might use the other stamp that's in this little set to go up in the corners, up in the top corners. Let's see. Maybe just get a little bit of swirl up there. I feel like I need like a big vat of water to put those dirty stamps in. And you can clean your stamps with just water and a toothbrush, old toothbrush.
Charity D, I just bought a bag of clear stamps at a thrift store, but don't own a block to use them on. Can I do it without?
Yeah, or get creative, look around. What actually works really good is to go to a hardware store and see if they have, that cuts glass, and see if they have any scraps of plexiglass. Those work great. And the nice thing is that they're flexible. So if you have a big stamp like this, you can really push it and make sure that you're making contact with the paper.
I've also in the past used, if you have like some old CD cases,
oh, yeah.
I use the plastic, you know, the plastic yep. case, just make sure it's dust free. I have used those in the past, and sometimes because they are bigger than some of the blocks you can get, mm-hmm. so you can put, you know, a bigger stamp on.
Die cutting pads work really well too.
Oh yeah, I wouldn't have thought of that, but yeah, you're right, that would work too.
Even when they get bowed, because when they get bowed, then you can kind of rock a stamp on there if it's a really big one. I have stamps that are too, they're too big to fit my Omega mount, so I use my die cutting pads for those. All right, so this is gonna take a little finesse. I'm gonna make sure you have enough room around your item to.
Barb Pollet? Question. I think I'm hearing that I need brushes for watercolor only, but may I use the same brushes for oil and acrylic?
You could use your acrylic brushes for watercolor, but once you invest in watercolor brushes, do not use them with anything else. They should stay for watercolor. You're not going to hurt your acrylic brushes by using them in watercolor, but you can harm your watercolor brushes by using them in acrylic. I do recommend getting a nice absorbent soft watercolor brush like the Mimics. Princeton Neptune's another good line. Royal Langnickel Zen. And they're fairly affordable. So, you know, it's, you know, I wouldn't get like a real animal hair brush. I mean, for one thing, the economy, but the other thing would be, you know, the cruelty factor. But I mean, nowadays they are so good. The synthetics are so good that I can't think of a reason why you would want to spend $100 on a brush where you can get its equivalent for, you know, under 20.
Stephanie Mueller, has there been a review of these paints yet?
Coming up this weekend. I filmed it. I just haven't, I filmed and uploaded. I just haven't posted it yet because I had other things going on. It'll be there tomorrow or Sunday, depending if I get another video film that I'm planning today. If I don't, then that will be tomorrow.
Soon.
Soon. Very soon. Let's see. What else should I put in there?
Azalea P, can we use watercolor on the jelly plates?
Yes, you can. You're going to have... Oh, that might be a good one. I got these cherry blossoms, too.
Oh, the cherry blossoms would be nice.
Oh, yes. I also brought my Mungio... water-soluble pastels that are pearlescent that I've got.
I always love the smell of oil pastels.
Me too. It smells
when I was a kid, when you get to use them in art, I always was like, oh, it smells so good.
Oh, you know, when the teacher got out the crayons, it was going to be a good day. It was
an excellent day. But I always like the smell of a new box of crayons, too. I always was like, but I also smell new books. I'm a weird.
These are the Lyra crayons somebody just asked about. So I thought, well, why don't we just use them and then you guys can see. Very comparable to Caran d'Ache, much cheaper. And it probably is something to do with the trade deals with whatever country these come from versus Switzerland. So what I'm going to do, and the nice thing about using these is I can go and just ink certain areas. I'm dipping my crayon in water and then just coloring over the area that I want to add the ink. I really like these. And I use them a lot if I'm going to do a workshop because I don't want to bring my Caran d'Ache necessarily because they're so expensive that they don't leave the house. They're my like stay at home supplies. So I'll bring these because I know that I can replace them if they get lost or stolen or broken or anything. I think I'm only gonna ink up the like half of these because I want to be able to kind of control where my, I'm kind of building a frame around this. So again, I'm gonna spritz it with water to activate that ink. This is by Rubbernecker, this stamp here.
Alexandra Manga, have you ever used the Zecchi brand of watercolor?
No, I've never heard of that.
Z-E-C-C-H-I.
Nope, I've never heard of that. Hmm. If anybody has used it, please help her out and let them know. All right, sometimes you can get two stampings, but usually need to spritz it again. So I'm going to see, that way I can fade something into this other area. Do be careful though, because if you're spraying the stamp, you're going to be getting water on the other parts of the rubber, and that could lift your paint in other areas. Sometimes I like my second stamping better than my first, and if you get too much on there, you can blot.
Charity D, would I be able to use my oil water soluble pastels over a watercolor painting with the fat lean rules?
You don't really need to. That's going to be fatter than your watercolor painting. Go ahead. It's not going to hurt anything.
It's starting to look kind of like Moroccan a little bit with the swirls.
Yeah, kind of. Those colors.
The colors with the swirlies. You just throw some gold in there, too.
Mmm.
I need to stop adding ideas.
Well, my sequins are downstairs, so. And my gold leaf. Actually, there might be some gold pastels in there. I don't know how bright they are. Actually, well, I put gold ink, because like this design has black outlines.
Yeah,
I didn't like the black outline. I could do gold
ink. You do have the pearls ink in here.
Let's see if I can get another
salmon pink.
Maybe I'll use that with some stencils.
Raw sienna. Black.
I like to see the second generation stamping over there. Whoops, you can't see that. Let me slide that over. The second generation stamping is a little bit crisper because there's less medium on it than there was over here. I don't really want to do too much more with this stamp because I think I'm getting a little carried away, so I'm just going to do a little bit there and a little there. All right. Sarah, there's a box of stencils under my art journal there. Could you pass that to me? I'm going to grab a couple stencils. I'm going to add some stenciling here and there with my water-soluble oil pastels. You could use the crayons. The crayons are a little firmer, so I don't think they're going to work as well as the pastels. I just have to find some stencils I want to use, and I will have to dry this before I do that because it will... Oh, yeah. Would you take that for me? That would be great.
Just in case.
Oh,
Alexandra Manga. Zecchi is a handmade watercolor made in Florence, Italy, but there is an importer here in the U.S. for them. They're supposed to be really nice.
Oh, okay. No, I've never heard of them.
They know how to make pasta, so why not?
Why not?
Why not watercolors?
Now, if you see a stencil that screams,
All right.
Let me know.
Okay,
Yeah, you're also watching the chat.
It's pretty. We've got our great moderators, though. So, and I'm actually caught up on some of the questions.
I think I might go with something like a honeycomb or something fairly organic and open looking.
Mm-hmm. Put some deer in the back there. That's organic.
That is organic. I'll give you that.
It wouldn't look good, though.
I don't think it would. Raindrops on our poor butterfly.
Raindrops keep falling on my head. That's all I. It's a song. Something. Ugh, that's bad. I don't know the words. And
that's all right. We don't need copyright ID claims.
I only did the one line. I think I'm safe. I think we just lost a few viewers though with that singing.
Oh, yeah, I should have planned this a little bit better. And
no, no,
stencil.
People are enjoying
that's kind of cool.
It's stretching out.
That might be kind of, what do you think?
I like that. Yeah, that's definitely.
That's kind of Moroccan, too.
And you're stretching out the Frugal Crafter video, which people are down for.
I know some people stream for like 4 hours and it's like, oh, my goodness. I know some of the people on Twitch that do the Twitch creative, they will stream like like 4 and 6 hours, just like they're just painting and they're streaming. It's like, oh my word. People must just come in and come and go during that period. Mm-hmm. I can't imagine they stay the whole time. Like Bailey J, who's a YouTuber that I enjoy, she'll do, oh, it's just a short stream, just 2 hours. It's like, oh my word. That's long for me.
Azalea P, will it damage the brush if we leave it in the water?
In the water overnight. If it has a wooden handle, yes. And it could damage the bristles. I got these butterflies.
Nah, I think too much butterfly. We don't want to take away.
I'll put that in the maybe pile then. Oh, some dots. You can always use polka dots.
Dots. I used to like dots when I was a kid. I always felt like they were going to yank my fillings out though. So
oh, those candies. Oh yeah, those are good. Yeah, I like dots.
Stuck to your tooth, and I was like, oh, what if I pops out a filling?
Yeah. That would stink. I was saying when you first said that, I was thinking the candy dots, you know, that came on the ribbon.
Like, oh, I used to like those too, colors. But that, now I can't stand the scraping of the teeth on the paper. Yeah. It gives me goosebumps just thinking about it.
Oh, these paper stencils, they're wonderful. The only thing I want to caution you about with them, they're great with acrylics. Just don't clean them. Let the acrylic pile up because then you'll have a nice plastic stencil after all the acrylic paint piles up. If you're using watercolors, the next time you use it with something else, so that color could transfer onto your project. So keep that in mind. I might risk it because there's a pattern there, like on another dot.
People are enjoying watching you go through your stash. So
yeah, these are just the small ones. I have a big file downstairs with the big ones.
This is just a small sample, people. Yep. Small sample.
If you want to see more stencils, look at my how to store stencils video. I have two of them, actually.
You have a lot of stencils.
How to store stencils in the gripping sequel. How to store more stencils.
How to store stencils, part two. More stencily than the first.
You thought I had a lot of stencils before. Hopefully that didn't mess up the microphone. I just hit the microphone.
Funny dude, how often do you wash your watercolor brushes?
I don't really wash them unless they get really stained. I just rinse them in the water and put them back in my bucket, honestly. All right, I'm going to use white, I think. Oh, I wonder if this is dry. I just put that on there. I'm going to heat
mistakes even the pros make.
Yeah, I'm going to dry this real quick. So if you have any more questions, go ahead and lay them on me, because I just don't want to smear all that around.
Then we have to add something to it.
That's
to
true.
Try and cover up the mistake.
It's just an opportunity for embellishment.
Right.
That's the mixed media. I mean, I think that's how the whole mixed media craze came along. Just a bunch of us artists that kept frigging up all the time. Like, so we had to.
I don't want
to
throw it away. Yeah. How can I fix it?
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, hi, Chewy. Hi, yes. Squish right in here.
Yeah, dog nose. I'm surprised that didn't show up on the camera.
I don't get burned. I can reach that far enough.
Ooh, I think I will do some splatters, though, because I got a splatter right there. Mm-hmm. I like the way that looks. Maybe some teal splatters. Mm. Okay, so let's see. I like polka dots because they go with pretty much everything. I'm not going to fill in every spot, though. I want to kind of keep a lot of stuff still showing through. So I'm just kind of going here and there. You pass me one of those cosmetic sponges that are in that tray there. Thanks. They're clean. They're just stained.
Gotcha.
And then I like to use a cosmetic sponge to blend. I'm just going to spritz it with a little water off camera so it can help loosen up the pigment I just put on there with the
Chewy, there can't possibly be crayons. That much down here.
Shouldn't be any food under there because I don't eat and craft at the same time.
Chewy.
Something else you can do is to wet the sponge. Because sometimes your watercolor paint is a little opaque. I really like to do this technique with the Gansai Tambay colors because the pans are so big. But I'm just wondering how opaque the opaque white is. I might be able to get some pigment on that way to help out that pastel. Probably I will end up losing some of the pearl in that pastel by doing this, but didn't seem very potent the way I had it on there. I'm just basically liquefying that pigment. You get a very subtle, it's a very subtle look. I'm not sure if you can kind of see it around in there. Maybe I need to go with a darker color. So maybe one of another kind of a turquoisey color. Well, Deborah, that's kind of pretty. Use that.
Deborah Sullivan, is there such a thing as tinted watercolor paper? Has Lindsay ever used it?
Yes, there is. No, I haven't used it because I think the beauty of watercolor is the fact that you have white paper and it's the light bouncing off the white that gives it its luminescence. So that's why I don't use it. I think that it would make your colors, it's going to affect all of your colors because watercolor is transparent. And I think that it would really make everything kind of dull. But I think it would be great for gouache because I like working on colored surfaces if I'm using gouache or watercolor crayons or any sort of opaque media. Another way you can wet your stamp, your blending tool, is to spray into your palette because you just don't want to get it sopping wet. If you get it too wet, you're going to squish the pigment underneath your stencil. You just want it wet enough that you can loosen up those particles. And these will have a little bit of shimmer to them because of they're the water-soluble pastels that are the pearlescent ones that I picked up on Jerry's sale.
Tumster Mom, I looked everywhere to figure out if there was a demo today and decided there wasn't. How can we find out in advance?
I post on my blog beforehand. I posted on Instagram this morning. My blog also posts to my Facebook page and my Twitter. So if you follow me on any of those spots, you should get it. Also, if you're a YouTube subscriber, hit the bell notification on my channel and it will give you updates. It should show up in your subscription feed. If you just go to youtube.com and click on subscriptions, it should show up in your subscription feed if you're subscribed. A lot of people don't bother checking their subscription feed, so they don't really know when something's going on. And YouTube doesn't send emails out unless you click that bell to notify you of new videos. So if you click that bell on my channel and you subscribe and click the bell, you should know. I'm adding a little bit of that blue over here to some of these white ones because I don't think they showed up very well.
On the red, they kind of did.
Yeah.
But from my perspective, yeah. Here.
You can also color your pastel onto your palette and pick it up. Like if I wanted like a lighter color, I can do my white and my blue and I can mix them together like that and make almost like an ink pad.
Michael Ann Fitzgerald, can you use watercolors with light modeling paste?
I wouldn't, just because if you get that stuff in your brushes or in your paints, then they're going to dry with a permanent film over them. And I think it could be difficult to get that paint working again. I wouldn't get any of the acrylic stuff on in your palette, I guess, is the, just put that on the finished painting. Could you move that clipboard for me?
Lindsay needs to clean her table up. I say that because this happens to me sometimes when I'm in my craft room. I'm like, wait a minute. I'm just stacking things on top of other things.
Yeah.
I need to clean up.
Maybe I could put this, I don't know, what do you think? Like kind of, but only stencil it behind the butterfly. What do you think? Can I make this one work?
I'm sorry, I wasn't listening. I zoned out for a second.
Oh, that's all right.
I actually think if you, again, I think it's too much, but I also tend to go for more simplistic designs myself when I do art stuff. You tend to be more ornate with multiple layers and fancier things.
You have this thing too. Like put a little bit of that in the corner, maybe. It's like a branch. Hmm. I think that because I've got tiny little openings there, I think that I will. Wondering, maybe I'll test that on a scrap of paper first. I'll use the back of my thing from yesterday. So I'm going to test this out because I'm not sure how it's going to go. I think I'll actually.
We have a vote for each to do it and to put it on, and a vote to not. So
I'm going to try this here and see what I think of the stencil. As long as I go in a color that I've used already, it probably isn't going to be too bad. Going in a brand new color might be a little
Definitely.
A little bit too much. Well, maybe a little bit around the edges. All right, I'm going to do it, but I'm going to do it with just on the edges. So I'm just spraying some water there so I can just barely ink up my sponge and then lift up the paint. So you have to be, when you have a small window, small windows like you do in these detailed stamps, you can't really go over with the crayons because it's not going to fit in the holes. I think I will need some outlining on the butterfly in either black or gold just because it's not going to stand out enough with it. Not sure if I really like that now that I've done it.
Well, it's...
I guess so. I better do it somewhere else so that it matches, so it at least looks like it was on purpose.
Right. Well, I think it's just because it's the same color, so there's not a pop. There's not a difference.
I think I'll sponge on a little bit of that color, too. Make myself a little more of a frame. I think that's part of, like, the big part of mixed media is if you'll kind of get to the point where you've made a mistake. It happens to everybody. And then repeating that mistake a few times so it becomes a design element, so it's no longer a mistake. It's actually, you make it part of the design. Might tell people to maybe stop the video, stop watching at a certain point, just in case they're like OCD. It's like, yeah, you're not gonna want to watch past like the hour mark. Things got a little hairy when the stencils came out.
When the stencils get pulled out, just turn it off.
And then you can be like, well, I have nothing to lose now, so you just start throwing stuff in, and then a lot of times that's when it gets really good because you
let go.
Yeah. And the green, these, you can see how close to opposites this teal and red are, is that when I rub the sponge over them and they mix, you get a nice gray. So they do kind of neutralize. They're super vibrant next to each other because they're opposites, but they neutralize each other when mixed together because they're opposites, so they cancel out the other colors. Actually, I kind of like that frame, though. That's going to be cool when I take away the... edge. Kind of wish I had a script stamp, though. I don't think I do. Like, you know, letters.
You probably do downstairs.
Oh, I do somewhere. Downstairs, but I was just kind of just grabbed a few from my background folder. Okay. I couldn't go in with a marker. I wish I had a gold pen up here because that would be kind of...
Should we go get a gold pen downstairs?
Fetch me a gold pen.
Fetch a gold...
Can you see if I have a gold pen in that drawer?
You do.
Sweet. Let's see if it works. I think it was one of our Yankee Swap gifts last year.
Are you saying it was inexpensive?
Oh, yeah. Dollar Tree special. I don't know if it's going to show up enough. I might have to go in with like gold paint later. Actually, though, I have some gold acrylic paint. Okay, guys, tell me in the comments, should I go for the gold acrylic paint and do some outlining in gold acrylic paint with this beast here? Let me know in the comments. Sarah's going to tell me.
Okay, I'm waiting.
And I'm going to look for, see, I got my gold. I bet I have gold.
We have a note already that says, tell Lindsay to please stop.
Who's that?
Gwyneth Simmons. And she put stop in all capitals. But then we have yes. Yes for gold. Yes. Yes. Pen. Go for the gold. Yes to the gold paint. Yes. Go for it. Yes, gold. Might as well. Gold
might acrylic as well. Paint.
No, I think black ink. Acrylic gold. Yeah, go for it.
All right, I'm going to do gold. And then if that fails miserably, then I will go with the black over the gold. Okay, can you pass me my lid over there so I can stick some... I've got these two colors. I'm going to see which one looks brighter.
No fear. All right, we have a purple.
This is my fancy palette. I grabbed it out of the recycling bin yesterday.
Nothing to lose. Go for it.
Yep.
Don't stop pen. Gold acrylic paint. Yes, with the gold. No gold pen. Yes.
Well, they just can't make up their minds.
They can't.
That's okay.
Gold on top and gold on bottom.
Too.
Gold pen, yes. Gold default, you need a little green. Yes to the gold.
I'm going to mix these two. I got a pearl yellow and this antique gold. I'm going to mix them so that I have a nice bright color. And I'm not using my watercolor brush. I'm using an acrylic brush because I do not want to have any residue. Yeah, it was more that I, like, in case I don't clean it very well, I don't want to have any gold paint.
All right, well, while you do that, I think Chewy might have to use... Oh, God, I bumped your chair.
That's okay. No.
We're close quarters today. Oh.
So I think with this, you could do as much or as little detailing as you want. Because you could even get in there and do the little veins on the butterfly if you wanted to, or you could just do like an outline. And I always have that black in the back of my pocket. If it doesn't work out well, I can go in with a black marker. I could go in with my mix, that dark mix color watercolor paint. I do not care for this brush for this use. I'm going to see if I have something with longer bristles. It's just not holding enough paint for me. This one might have a little bit longer bristles. Oh, this one's got longer bristles. It is a fatter brush, but I think, you know, if I use good brush control, I should be able to get it to do what I want it to do. So that's why I say you should always use the biggest brush that you can, because it's going to hold more paint. It's going to be a little less tedious because you don't have to go back. You want to twirl your brush in the paint, kind of twirl it to get a nice point when you're using a viscous paint like acrylic. Because unlike watercolor, the weight of the water is not going to point your brush. The acrylic paint will be permanent, so the only way to get rid of it will be to go over it with something else. You can go over it with a alcohol marker. Just keep in mind that alcohol is a solvent for acrylic. So I wouldn't do it with like your expensive Copics. Do it with like a Sharpie, something inexpensive, so that if it does dissolve the acrylic and the acrylic gets into the nib, it's not going to, you know, you're not going to be out a expensive marker.
Well, I think your jury's order might have come. You got two packages from UPS.
Awesome.
I didn't look and see who it was from.
Looks like we'll be having a haul video coming up too,
yay,
folks. Sweet. I ordered a 10-sheet pack of that Langton paper. I kind of wish as I was ordering, I'm like, oh, I probably should get two because it's on the closeout price, but I see they extended the sale, so.
Well, one of them is a flat box.
Ooh, that, like, I bet that's my paper.
Paper.
Yay. So. It's hard to see, but if you look at an angle, you can see the see the gold.
Well, you also don't want it to be like blurry gold outline, because then it would look weird.
Yeah. I wouldn't want this to look gaudy or anything.
It's not gaudy.
Actually, it's really fun. I'm having a good time doing this. I like the colors. I really wanted to give this paint set a workout. Because, I mean, it's inexpensive considering the price of artists' watercolor paint, but it's not, you know, cheap. I spent some money on it, so, you know, you kind of want to make sure that you got something decent. And I would say these colors are not weak. I can also fill in any gap if I have like a pencil line, or if I have a space between the background and the foreground. I can do that with this gold. Remember, every time I'm twisting my brush in the paint so I get that nice point. And also remember that if you're working with acrylics and you're finding that you just don't feel like you have the control, sometimes it's not, you need to go to a smaller brush. Like in my instance today, I needed a bigger brush or a brush with longer bristles so I could hold more paint. So use the biggest brush that you're comfortable with, because it will save you time and aggravation. I try to keep my hand out of the way. I'm resting my pinky, like the edge of my hand, on my paper so that I keep a steady hand while I'm doing this line. So my pinky finger is on the paper and I'm just sliding it as I slide my brush. I'm moving my whole arm. It's not just my wrist. And that's how you can get good brush control, even if you're not very steady handed.
Deborah Sullivan, I feel I only want to use only the most transparent pigments. Is that realistic, or should I include some opaque pigments?
I think it's good to have some, both, because transparent watercolor will have some opaque pigments in it, like ultramarine blue, because its sedimentary qualities make it semi-transparent instead of fully transparent. But that granulation is such an important texture to have. I think some brands are going to be more transparent than others. I think Core is an extremely transparent brand. So is Mission Gold. So you can choose one of the more transparent brands, but I would not I wouldn't not use like burnt sienna or any of the other earth tones, yellow ochre and things like that, just because you're trying to avoid transparency. You're trying to avoid opaque colors. So I think you'd really miss out on a lot of really nice colors that way. But you will get bright colors if you just stick to transparent colors. It's your opaque ones that do tend to muddy things up. But I don't think you're going to have a muddy painting if you use the opaque colors. It just, within the realm of transparent colors, there are some opaque colors, but semi-opaque colors, I wouldn't avoid them. I think they provide more benefit than negative. Should I do black on there, do you think?
I don't know.
I feel... You're shabby. Oh, I got a micron.
You do have a micron.
Oh, I got a white gel pen too.
I don't know, maybe.
I'll do some white because we pretty much got rid of all of the white.
People want to see the sparkle of the gold. Can you
take
it?
Yeah, sure. I got to catch the light here. Oh, maybe I can catch the light there.
There we go.
There. Yeah, I thought you can really see it right there. Mm. I like it, actually.
I think it looks good. I think it was better than outlining the whole thing in black.
I think maybe I'll do a little white, though, because then that will bring a little more vibrancy. Not that this needs more vibrancy, but I mean it will push my colors a little bit. I'm really excited to take the tape off.
Jeannie Atkins, new to the live tutorials, how do you know when to stop? When I try to do more than basic, it doesn't look good.
Usually I go too far and then I have to spend some time fixing my problems. So I'm not the best person to ask that. I think the best advice would be to not try to do it all in one go and to take a break and come back and look at it the next day when you're thinking, well, maybe it's done. That's probably the time to stop and then come back with fresh eyes or look at it in a mirror, then you'll be able to tell a lot more accurately what else needs to be done. I think maybe just some super, somebody was asking about adding black afterwards. I think I will do a little bit just so, I think it's a good teachable moment and I don't really have any big plans for this painting. So why not? This is a really fine black pen too. It's not going to affect too much. This is a 0.01, or it's an 0.01 micron. So it's a little bit finer than your ultra fine Sharpie. So I'm just doing some little accent lines. I'm gonna do some on the back. This is actually where some of the printing was on the advertisement. It must have been like a postcard, I'm thinking, because I don't think it would show up in like a magazine. It's kind of, I didn't even realize it was writing on it until I printed it out large. I was talking about, I have a collection of these books and they're all public domain images and they came as CD-ROMs. And this was one of them that I found, and I love those books. I don't know if they still print them. They're called Memories of a Lifetime. But I've actually seen this image on the Graphics Fairy and on other websites as well, because I always do a double check to make sure it really is public domain and mm-hmm. it hasn't been misrepresented, because I don't want a lawsuit or something. I think just those little bits of black on top of some of the darker areas is helpful. I think it's bringing out, it's helping the colors around. All right, maybe just a little. The Micron won't dissolve the acrylic paint underneath. So if you do have Microns, they're not an alcohol base. They're like an India ink or something. So they're not going to dissolve like the alcohol markers will. They're not a terribly robust nib though, so you do have to be careful if you have a lot of texture on your watercolor paper. If you had like a rough watercolor paper, it's going to toast your Micron nibs, so I really wouldn't do it on that. Best for like a hot press or a cold press that's fairly smooth like this one.
Jordan Sinclair, what is a good watercolor sketchbook?
I've used the Canson Montville sketchbook that I like. I just reviewed the Cachet one, which is on sale at Jerry's right now for $12, and it actually came with free Langton Prestige ATC cards, and that's why I ordered the paper, because I really like those. And it comes with a free brush. It's not bad. It's Aquafine paper, if you're familiar with that. So it's not the best, but it's okay. I like the Strathmore Wind Power has a it's not a hardbound sketchbook. It's just like a paper bound, has a hard back, but a paper bound pad, but it's spiral bound, so your papers will stay together. I really like that paper. It's quite robust. It's cellulose, so it's not going to be quite as durable as a cotton paper, but for a sketchbook, I think it's quite nice. All right, I think that's done. What do you think?
I think it's done. I think you need to walk away.
Yep.
And if you probably need to, you can come back later and add to it.
That's true. I want to thank everybody that came by today. If you would like to get some more mixed media action, check out Lifebook 2017. I have seen some of the artwork that just started. It's not too late to join. And I have a coupon code in the video description for 20% off. So make sure you check that out. It's a year-long art class. Basically, you have new class every week, 24 instructors, people that you've heard of before, Julie Fifhambalzer, Vicky Papianenu, other YouTubers that you know. And just this first week, seeing the artwork that's come out of the students is amazing. If you'd like to check it out, click the link in the video description, and support of purchasing those classes help support the channel here so that I can make more free tutorials for you. And if you need supplies, check out our sponsor, jerrysartorama.com. They have everything you need and more, and they're extending their overstock sale, so I highly recommend taking a few minutes or hours or whatever and just going through that, because it's some wicked good deals.
You never know what you're going to find.
My invoice, my last thing, it's free shipping on over $59. I spent $59.20. I saved $169. I mean, that's crazy. It's awesome. So
how could you not buy that stuff then?
Seriously.
Really?
I know. I know. It's like if I don't shop, then I'm just losing money.
Yeah, basically. You are losing money. Basically. It's just languishing, not being used.
Yep. Yeah, see? Wrong. She knows what I mean.
That's wrong.
If you have any questions, go ahead and leave them in the comments after the video is done, and I will get back to you if I didn't get a chance to answer your question live on air today. And please leave a like. Hit the thumbs up button before you go. That really helps my channel, and it helps encourage you to show these videos to other people that may not know about us. Thank you so much for watching, and until next time, happy crafting.